years now. I'm working at SAP Cloud Foundry core team, and I'm responsible for metering of SAP cloud platform and Cloud Foundry part.
Hi, my name is Stoyan Rachev. I'm also working at SAP as an architect, and I've been working on Cloud Foundry related projects since about 2 years now. And today, we want to talk about building distributed cloud native applications with Node.js. And in particular, we want to touch upon one magical property of distributed systems known as resilience. We define resilience as the ability of systems to withstand, tolerate, and recover from failure. And in this talk, we would like to look at these issues from several different angles, examine different kinds of failures that we need to tolerate, and also talk a little bit about how we failed in handling them properly, but in the beginning, but eventually learn to do this better.
So this talk is about the problems we faced when trying to work with Cloud Foundry Abacus. And let's dig a bit deeper into what Abacus is. I don't know how many of you were on the session about monetizing your applications from our colleague, but the scenarios we are talking about is that we have a lot of desktop, mobile applications, even IoT devices that work with the cloud, and they work with services, applications, APIs that basically use cloud compute resources. And what we are trying basically to explain is how we do the metering of all these resources and how we try to monetize them. We do this with a project by IBM, that's Abacus. And this project is a sophisticated metering engine that does things like collecting data, aggregation, accumulation across several different dimensions, like Cloud Foundry organizations, spaces, and across different time units. All this data is then collected, aggregated, accumulated, as I've said, and sent to the billing engine. And that allows us to monetize these used resources, and they finally end up in the invoice of our clients. So from architectural point of view, this is how Abacus looks like. It's a set of a lot of different microservices deployed as Cloud Foundry applications. The project started as IBM internal project, was contributed in 2015 to Cloud Foundry Foundation. And we're working on that project for almost a year now. And all these microservices basically constitute a MapReduce pipeline. The first two stages are basically the map part of the pipeline, and the accumulate and aggregator are the reduce part of the pipeline. The input is JSON documents that contain the usage sent to Abacus as small JSON documents, basically, almost a free form. And we process them through the pipeline and get report back. So collector does storing of these documents into the database, metering does transformation from one unit of measurement to another, basically the unit of measurements we choose to present to our customers. And this can be regarded as an example, bytes to gigabytes. So that's the unit we chose to present to the customers. Accumulator accumulates across different time dimensions, like seconds, minutes, hours, up to month. So we get a breakdown to these different units. And aggregator aggregates across organizations and spaces. So this is how Abacus looks like from an architectural point of view. And the first topic we want to touch is networking. The problems we had there, as Stoyan said, how we felt to the things, and in the end, how we intend to fix everything. Well, if you do a search in internet about distributed computing, you might end up into these fallacies of distributed computing. We knew that we'll have problems. We knew that the network is not reliable, latency will be a problem, bandwidth also will be a problem, the topology of Cloud Foundry or our application would not stay the same, and we'll have, for example, updates, and that would probably will face an issue or two. But knowing and believing in this are different things, and yeah, Stoyan will present you how we became believers in all these fallacies.
Yeah, so what are the issues that we actually face? So first of all, the network is not reliable, meaning that the connectivity between the different stages of our pipeline may simply be broken at any given moment or unstable. Second, even if the connectivity is there, the bandwidth may be insufficient, and therefore the latency may be low. And finally, even if everything with the network is working okay, some of the stages of our application can be down, not responding due to the fact that they have crashed or due to updates. And all this motivates connectivity design that is highly tolerant to all these kinds of failures. How do we do it? It all starts with retry. So if something, if a request doesn't come through, or if we do not get a response to the request, we simply retry it. However, this has to be done carefully because maybe the downstream application is not responding because it's overloaded. And then if you keep retrying, you actually make the situation worse. So we use exponential backoff, and we increase gradually the amount of time between two consecutive retries in order to avoid this issue. Second, we also use circuit breakers, Hystrix style circuit breakers. So if you're familiar with that, circuit breaker will flip the connection open if retry doesn't help, and will in this way prevent cascading failure from propagating through the system. When the connectivity is back, the circuit breaker will close, and retrying and normal request response can continue. We also use two other techniques to increase the throughput. The first one is batching. We batch many different requests into a single one, compressed one, and we can even batch requests that go to different endpoints on the same host into the same request. This allows us to make much more efficient use of the open network connections and ultimately to achieve higher throughput. Finally, we also use throttling. With throttling, we limit the number of requests that we send up to a certain predefined limit and queue the rest for a certain amount of time. Throttling also allows us to control the amount of data we send over the network much more effectively. And all these different techniques taken together are really they play very nice together, and they come to a very effective solutions to the network issues I mentioned previously. However, there is another kind of issues that we do not cover with these techniques, and they are related to the availability of our application instances themselves. And they may not be available due to various reasons, so the platform may be updated, the backing services may be updated, the applications may be updated, or maybe they have crashed, and here Cloud Foundry helps us because it will restart the applications in this case, and it also allows us to use blue-green deploy and minimize the downtime during updates. However, for data crunching applications like Abacus, we have this issue: what happens if the application crashes just before it was able to write the process data to the database? We need to be able to recover from such situations. To do that, we use a technique we call replay. We have an input database and an output database. We after an application starts, it will check the input database for any documents that do not have corresponding output database documents, and we'll replay the processing of those documents in order to ensure that the issue doesn't happen.
Well, even with all these techniques, we still need to have redundancy, because in order to guarantee availability, usually that's the way we do it. And well, redundancy comes at a cost. One of the things we need to consider is scaling. Does our applications have the ability to scale horizontally? If they do, then we should consider how much do we need to scale. That usually goes with the cost, so we cannot afford infinite scaling of our applications. And even if we can afford that, we need to discover which of our instances are actually up and which are down and not working, and that goes with discovery. So we need to discover which of our applications basically runs, and to do that, we might face a problem in Cloud Foundry. Why? Because in Cloud Foundry, we have Go router. That's pretty much okay with applications. We have router, we have a URL for our applications, and if we request that application, we usually end up requesting a single instance. And Go router does round robin by default, so we cannot tell exactly which instance we'll be actually accessing. So we cannot basically pull data for monitoring out of our applications. We can, of course, use techniques like pushing data to some server or service, but that means we need to change our applications. We need to inject some code inside, and we cannot simply pull data out of it. And using some things like Hystrix Eureka is not really an option. So we have a problem there. How we try to solve this? Well, we came up with some idea to basically have index applications or numbered applications. So on the previous picture, we had like six collectors in production, and we numbered all of them like 0, 1, 2, 3. So all of them had URLs, so we can easily go and fetch some data out. Of course, this means we'll have to run them with a single instance, because otherwise we have still the same problem. So we kind of solved the problem. Now we can monitor them, but we still had a problem, because in reality, we to access from one application to the next one, basically to push data through the pipeline, we either had to use backend service or go through the router. And Abacus currently uses the second approach, so we wanted to minimize the number of used services. And that's really a problem also, because that means we have a lower performance. We always go through the router, because that's how we can access applications in Cloud Foundry, through URL. And router does the lookup. This is also a security problem, because all of our applications need to be exposed to the internet. Why? Because they had to be seen from the internet and from the applications in the pipeline. And not all of our stages actually need to be externally visible, probably just the first one and the last one, the reporting. And how do we solve this? Well, here container networking comes to the rescue. Unfortunately, it's not released yet, or we had the first release, I think, before the summit. But it's still not productive in the major platforms out there. So let's see how the container networking and in particular container-to-container communication solves our problems. Well, we no longer need to use these index applications nor going through the router. We can use things like Eureka or any service discovery out there that needs direct access between the applications. So we have both monitoring and discovery. What else do we have? Well, we have performance because we basically can access our applications. And we have increased security. We can have rules that forbid access from the internet, for instance. So container networking is really helping here.
Yeah, and Abacus is written in Node.js. Why does this matter? How does this help compared to any other language or platform? And we would like to mention two things. First of all, Abacus was written in ECMAScript 6 from the very beginning, and using a very consistent approach of building upon all the latest features in the JavaScript language available in ECMAScript 6. And especially, it uses functional programming concepts such as higher order functions in order to enable very elegant and powerful composition of functions from other functions. The second thing we would like to mention is that since Abacus, Node.js is asynchronous, it makes very easy to use a reactive approach to building modern applications. However, the default callback-based style of asynchronous execution used in Node.js, if you try to use that in any real-life complexity, you may very easily find yourself with code that is very hard to maintain due to the so-called callback hell. Fortunately, in ECMAScript 6, there is this generator feature that makes it very easy to write a synchronous flow in a way that it actually resembles synchronous flow. So without any callbacks, just using generators and the yield keyword. But it's still asynchronous, it's still reactive. And if you, we can consider, for example, this line of code in which we compose a function that is actually a request having all the features we mentioned previously. So it's read-write, it's throttled, it's batched, and it uses a circuit breaker. And it's also a generator and can be yielded upon to return the result directly into the response directly without using a callback. And it's still asynchronous.
Well, we saw that as well. Of course, that's why we wanted to share with you the things in this session. And the problem was that we had near terabyte per day in some situation, depending on your installation. That means a lot of data flowing through Abacus pipeline. And since we had really small documents, that meant that we had a lot of them as well. So how did we manage to basically do that? Well, we had partitioning. That's pretty old technique. And if you Google it, of course, you'll find this characteristic. We like it very much because it helps us to manage our data. It helps us to distribute the load between several databases, to do things like taking data offline. And because we use partitioning, we can afford basically to have keys generated in our applications on app level. We do this because our data is basically time-based. We receive the data with certain start and end times, and we make a key that is basically based on the time. We store it in Mongo or Couch databases. So all of this basically allows us to delete data. We can either take it offline when we no longer need it. For example, previous month database can be simply taken offline or backed up or whatever you can think of. But more importantly, we can do things like retention. Either we can say we still need that data, or we can basically say we don't need that data because we have legal requirements, like we should not keep data longer than 3 months. So we already know that we have partitions based on the month we receive the data, so we can simply delete the whole partition, and that helps us solve these legal requirements.
Do not pay proper attention to monitoring. So how do we do that in Abacus? Besides using Hystrix style circuit breakers, we also use Hystrix streams. And these are very convenient because they allow you to stream data about the health of your applications, the traffic, the state of the circuit breakers, and the error percentage. To monitor all this in standard pieces of infrastructure, such as, for example, the Hystrix dashboard. If you have used Hystrix in the past, you're probably familiar with that. So in this dashboard, you can monitor a single Hystrix stream coming from a single instance of one of the applications. So that's quite good. However, we have many applications in many instances, and we actually wanna have an aggregated combined picture, and we do that first by registering our applications in Eureka, that Hristo mentioned already, and by using Turbine that aggregates the per instance streams into per application streams that are much more useful. However, there is a drawback to this approach. And to actually use it, you need direct communication between your applications, Eureka, the different pieces of the Hystrix infrastructure. And that is really, you can take full advantage of this if you have this container networking release that that Hristo mentioned previously. And second, you need an Eureka client in all of your applications. So you need to instrument them properly in order to take advantage of this. So what if we wanted to monitor our applications without all this complexity?
Well, probably we would. Use for debugging and even monitoring productive systems. And what Mozzle does is basically pulling data out of Cloud Foundry nozzles, because they contain not only logs, but also metrics. And by using it, we are able to pull metrics, feed them into Riemann and Influx database, and on top, use Grafana to visualize all this. And this helps us, as I said, not only debug when we are developing, but also monitoring productive systems, because this solution does not have performance impact. The metrics are always there, so you don't need to instrument your applications. We just connect and pull them into database so we can analyze them. And if we have all the data, we can get something like this. We get request times, we get types of requests, number of requests that failed. We can even pull the data from Hystrix, and not really using Hystrix dashboard, but using Grafana, we can visualize the Hystrix data as well. So we can get which circuit breakers flipped open and what this resulted in, like error codes, restarts, whatever we have there. So that's really nice. We have the metrics. And the next thing we want to do is basically to have alerts when we have problems. How we do this? Well, usually we just hook the events to some alerting, and that's the reactive approach. I believe everyone basically does this. The guys from IBM came with pretty nice idea. Anomaly detection and machine learning. We have the first steps in Abacus already. And the idea there is to basically build a profile, or to have the pattern of our resource consumers and resource providers, basically the two sides of the pipeline. So if you push data to Abacus, you probably push it like once a minute, once a second, whatever interval you decided. And if you stop pushing data, that's a change in the pattern. So you get instantly alert because something changed. Probably the network is no longer there, or simply you don't have usage. In either way, you've changed something. So probably someone needs to know about that. Either customers started using it wrongly, whatever happens, we need to know it. And that's really easy to do because we don't have to do anything, basically. We don't have already to define some rules or to do something manually when some new customer decides to use our platform.
And here we wanted to talk about late, and we are running out of time. I will skip actually this part. And we come to the takeaways from today's session.
Yeah, the first thing for us, they're pretty hard because we had a lot of problems with networking. We had a lot of issues with monitoring the whole solution. We had to come up with ways to basically overcome the limitations, some limitations of 12 factor even, because we needed to pull data out of our applications, and container networking helped a lot.
Fortunately, we also use Node.js. Mainly because of the asynchronous nature of Node.js, because of the possibility to use really powerful composition techniques from functional programming with the latest language features. And last but not least, because of generators, which allow us to do asynchronous programming and reactive programming, and still have code that is highly readable and maintainable.
About native applications, I think everyone of you knows this. And what helped us a lot is the container networking. I already mentioned this several times, but also the upcoming version 3 API that will basically allow us to deploy Abacus is a set of processes, not really single process applications, that will allow us to bring the different pieces together and to increase even more the throughput. And will also allow us to make the operations of the whole solution really easier, because currently we have around 60 applications running, and that even for automated system is a bit of a nightmare. If something happens, you still need to do a lot of retries, even on CF push level. So we hope with version 3 that would become much easier. Thank you, and I believe it's time for questions.
We can take a couple. In the case of Java, we have a lot of sample code basically from big vendors sort of thing, and very credible type of code basically, either from private or from IBM. Do you have such sort of resources for Node.js, for Mozzle or things like that? We can get a glimpse of the real working code on which we can build up some real GitHub URI or something of that sort.
Yeah, the source is already available. It's open source project, it's part of Cloud Foundry Foundation, it's in the incubator at the moment. Yeah, and if you have a look at cf-abacus, you'll find it easier. Cf-abacus, that's the name of the project. It's in the incubator. So there you can see a lot of our modules. They're already published in the registry, NPM. So you can simply either download it or contribute whatever you want. It's open source.
Okay, one last question back here.
Do you have your Grafana dashboards exported? Are they generic enough that they can assume, you know, general CF metrics, or are they more so customized to your own app? And then B, if they're generally available, would you be averse to sharing out the dashboards?
You mean the dashboard we showed here? Okay, the Grafana is also open source. It's part of the Mozzle. We simply use it as it is for debugging. And if you want to modify it, you can simply have it and play with it. It's part of the Mozzle project.
Okay, so you're not doing anything custom?
We are doing, but we don't have it open sourced.
Okay, fair enough.
Thank you very much.